This is Washelli Cemetery in Seattle. Here are buried Harry Reagan and Joe Goldsberry, killed by scabs in the 1916 strike. In Tacoma, you'll find the grave of the martyred Scotty Laidlaw. For those who survived the strike, the employers established the Fink Hall and the Shape Up, except in Tacoma, where the men kept their own hiring hall. The West Coast longshoremen learned from the 1916 strike that they had to have port-to-port cooperation and strong ties with the Marine unions and the Teamsters. For 18 years, they worked at it. And in 1934, they were ready. This is the story of the 1934 strike.
Tiny, when did the 34 strike start?
Well, the actual strike was called for the morning of the 9th of May, 1934. And at that time, when all the seafaring groups and ourselves, the longshoremen, had agreed on the date and the time. And the strike started at midnight. Pickets were placed. The coast was in a very quandary in regard to the strike. San Pedro hadn't voted as yet to go on strike up by that 8th of May. Seattle hadn't voted to go on strike by the 8th of May. And they made up their mind on midnight. We were unified for the morning of the strike.
This is the Joint Northwest Strike Committee. 66 men elected to serve as a general strategy board for the 1934 strike. They represented the locals from Anacortes, Astoria, Bellingham, Everett, Grays Harbor, Longview, Raymond, Port Angeles, Port Townsend, Portland, Seattle, and Tacoma. Associated with them in the strike were the Marine Cooks and Stewards Union, the Marine Firemen, the Master's Mates Pilots, and the Sailors Union. In the center of the picture is Ernie Tanner, a leader in the Tacoma local since 1918. Among the 1916 veterans serving on the Joint Northwest Strike Committee were Con Nagstead from Portland, Art Wilbert, George Clark, Art Whitehead, William Steamboat Bow from Seattle, and Walt Freer and Ed Harris from Tacoma. Walt Freer was elected chairman of the Joint Northwest Strike Committee, and Ed Harris became the secretary. William Patty Morris and John Bjorklund represented Pacific Northwest on strike negotiations in San Francisco. Both were veterans of the 1916 strike. The Joint Northwest Strike Committee had to figure out how to counteract employer strike strategy. The employers had closed down all but Seattle, Portland, San Francisco, and Los Angeles docks. They hired scabs and guards and demanded police protection. Cooperation existed between the Joint Northwest Strike Committee and the San Francisco Joint Marine Strike Committee. Delegates were exchanged and close contact was kept throughout the strike. There was close port-to-port cooperation. No local tried to settle on the side. They all stood together. Nor would they let ILA President Joseph Ryan make a deal. The rank and file would settle for nothing less than control of the hiring hall. It was the central issue of the strike. It would be a fight to the finish. The men had learned the lessons of the 1916 strike well. This photo commemorates the first significant event of the 1934 strike. It was Gauntlet Day on May 12, 1934, 2,000 longshoremen from Seattle, Tacoma, Aberdeen, and Everett hit the Seattle docks to drive out the scabs. Buck Wiley said it best.
We went to Alaska Steam at Pier 1, and then to Pier 2. We got a bunch of them out there. Then we went down to the old Nelson dock where young boys were working. They were discharging oranges, and we got them out. From there we went down to American Hawaiian at Stacy and Lander. The high point was at Pier 2, when 75 scabs filed through a crowd of strikers. Last to come out was the foreman, Iodine Harradine.
The clearing of the scabs on May 12th marked the greatest victory for longshoremen since the formation of the Seattle and Tacoma Stevedore Unions in 1886. After the scab clearing episode, the mayors of Tacoma, Seattle, Portland, San Francisco, and Los Angeles tried to open the waterfronts with police, all at the same time. In Tacoma on June 20th, 50 guards and scabs bussed to the waterfront, but 400 longshoremen were there to meet them. After a short parley, the scabs and guards departed. In Seattle, at Smith Cove, now Pier 91, employers brought scabs and guards by boat to the warehouses. The strikers picketed on Magnolia Bridge and the railroad tracks. They wouldn't let trucks, cars, or railroad engines get to the docks. To stop the train, 200 pickets surrounded the engine. A half dozen strikers boarded the engine to talk to the crew. The strikers persuaded the trainmen not to enter the pier area. The train crew reported to supervisors that the tracks were unsafe. It was the first time railroad engineers had supported a waterfront strike in the history of Puget Sound area. One of those who boarded the train was Wayne Moisio. Police labeled him the train stopper. The employers hired scabs in downtown Seattle. There were frequent street battles between strikers, scabs, and police. This newsreel footage shows the situation. Meanwhile, at Smith Cove, the horse mounties made a determined effort to get rid of the strikers once and for all. After the tear gas rained down from the bridge, police arrested 44 strikers. It took four police to arrest one longshoreman in his white hat. In 1988, 54 years later, John Mahoney, seaman, and eight longshoremen gathered at Smith Cove to relive the tear gas attack. This is Shelby Daffron, a Seattle longshoreman, delegate to the Joint Northwest Strike Committee. He led strikers to Point Wells.
Well, they were going out there to get in, and this guard shot him. The guy took a shot, just come out of the bushes and shot.
Daffron is buried in the family plot in Lakeview Cemetery. He was one of seven strikers who lost their lives in the 1934 strike. This plaque, created by Ron Gustin, symbolizes the 1934 strike. The men gained their own hiring hall. It took seven lives to do it, and July 5th is forever remembered as an honored day. This is the legacy of the 1934 strike. It gave hope to other unions. The 1935 struggle of timber workers in Tacoma was fought at 11th and A Street. Longshoremen were right there beside the timber workers in the worst of it.
Hey, Union Brothers. mother and a Union sister, a Union brother and a Union sister, way over in that Union burying ground. A Union father and a Union mother, and a Union father and a Union mother, way over in that Union burying ground. Well, I'm gonna sleep in a Union.
Before you is the living memorial established by the Seattle Longshore Local for the veterans of the 1916 strike. There are 98 trees, and at the foot of each tree is the grave of a longshoreman. Over in Tacoma, there are 31 graves for the charter members of their 1886 union. The Portland dead are buried in the Lone Fir Cemetery. There can be no more fitting tribute than Woody Guthrie's song, Union Burying Ground.
In that Union burying ground, every new grave brings a thousand brothers, and every new grave brings a thousand sisters to the Union in that Union burying ground.